Okay, perhaps we can begin. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jatin Nathwani. I'm the Executive Director of the Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy. I'd like to welcome you. I'd like to welcome you because these public lecture series, we value them highly, and they're wonderful opportunities to share the kind of thinking that goes on here at the Institute to a broader audience. So just for curiosity, I would like to ask, how many of you are from outside the university or have nothing to do with the university, but this subject, you found it of interest and thought you might come and listen to it? Or are most of you just associated with the university, teachers and students and so on? Anyone from outside the university? A few. Welcome. I know the walls of the university are forbidding and people tend not to come to university lectures because for one reason or the other. And for all of you from within the university, it's a summertime, it's a busy time for most people, so thank you for coming, and I hope this lecture will leave you with some insights. It is an important subject. You may or may not be familiar with a recent symposium held by University of Waterloo and Perimeter Institute at the Equinox Energy Summit. And this particular subject, this whole idea that a large proportion of the world's population has no access to electricity is kind of an unconscionable thing. And what can science and technology do to deliver a set of solutions so that there is available a reasonably high quality level of energy to this mass of humanity that doesn't have it? And of course, that is easily said and complained about, but what can we do in terms of technical solutions? That's what we're working on here. And this lecture by Professor Murthy fits into that particular theme of developing what we call microgrids for the world's needing, as it were. Let me take a moment to introduce Professor Murthy, who is an eminent scholar and a researcher in this area. He comes to us from IIT Delhi, the Indian Institute for Technology in Delhi. He received his bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degrees in electrical engineering from these universities, Bangalore University in India, IIT Bombay, and IIT Delhi, respectively. And then he joined the faculty of the Institute for IIT Delhi in 1970 and became a professor there. He is currently also the chair of the Central Electricity Authority. I won't read his entire bio sketch, but try and give you a couple of the highlights. His major responsibilities have included being chair of the Electrical Engineering Department at IIT Delhi, heading a research institution, IRDA, in Baroda, and Technical University in Suratgaon. He has written over 250 papers, supervised over 100 graduate students, sponsored 80 plus research projects on energy converters and energy systems, and 8 patents to his name. His awards are many, include the ISTE Award for Outstanding Research, IIT Bimal Bose Award for his contributions in power electronics, and he's a fellow of the Indian National Academy of Engineering. I have gotten to know him over the last few years. He was India coordinator of the Indo-Canada workshop on electricity generation using renewable energy, jointly organized by IIT Delhi and the Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy. And he was also the general chair of the INAE Conference on Research Policy for Sustainable Energy, again in Delhi in 2009. He's visiting us for this summer for a brief period, for a couple months, here at Waterloo and at Ryerson. So we're most pleased to have him here and share with us his thoughts on this important subject. Professor Murthy.
Thank you, Jatin, for this more than deserving introduction. I have two E's as my passion. One is energy, other is education. And we have been together trying to activate some joint activities. And I have deliberately chosen a topic which concerns a vast section of the world's population. And who are not having access to the so-called grid electricity. And it is not feasible, nor desirable, nor economical, nor viable to give everybody a grid electricity in the world of today, except perhaps the people of North America, it appears. And therefore, can we think of a cell phone type of a scenario in the power sector? You have created a cell phone in the communication sector. Can we think of a cell phone in the power sector? So can we think of new technology, new type of paradigms in which we give the people the power, we give the power back to the people, we give the power in their hands. Okay? So can we think of a new paradigm, and in view of the new situations of the survival of the planet? Now I thought I will start off with a video clip from the speech of the Indian Prime Minister. Okay.
Each one of us gathered here today acknowledges that those worst affected by climate change are the least responsible for it. Whatever emerges from our negotiations must address this glaring injustice. Injustice to the countries of Africa, injustice to the least developed countries, and injustice to the small island developing states whose very survival as viable nations is in jeopardy. Our targets include installation of 20,000 megawatts of solar energy capacity by the year 2022, improving energy efficiency of our economy by 20% by 2020, and adding an additional 6 million hectares of forests over the next 7 years. As responsible citizens of the globe, we have agreed to take on a voluntary target of reducing the emission intensity of our GDP growth by around 20% by the year 2020 in comparison to 2005. We will deliver on this goal regardless of the outcome of this conference. The Kyoto Protocol should continue to stand as a valid legal instrument. Parties to the protocol should deliver on their solemn commitments under this protocol.
Just give us 2 minutes clip on in the northern state of Punjab, there are a lot of flowing canals, and one entrepreneur has developed a turbine which will just dip into these canals, and it will, okay, you can see this, yeah, sure. Okay, just about 2 minutes to... So there is a energy or power in the water. So you have vertical axis Darius type of turbine. It runs at low speed, and with this we can produce electricity and give it to the people who are living in the nearby. So this is a technological challenge. Whether you are a standalone mode or a grid connected mode, there are a lot of such. In fact, I am sure you may have thousands of such canals in Canada also, you know, there is enough of hydropower. So they have shown that it is possible. I mean, these are some of the crude measurements which is done, that it is possible to convert that flow of energy, flow into electricity. But how to make it work and deliver is the main question, okay? Okay, we can stop this, I think. Right, maybe we can. Right, so I may just start, we have this couple of these clips just to sensitize you on this. One is the political statements of what is to be done, and other is the what is the role of the technologists in making things happen. Okay. Now, of course, we all know that energy crisis is a reality. Okay, but I don't have to overemphasize this. And the greenhouse gas emissions, then climate change, the global warming, and you know, depleting fossil fuels. So they are all the realities, and we are all concerned about this. So it is just all is contributing to the rise in the temperatures of the globe. Okay, now. So the emission status, now there is in Copenhagen, they say we call it what is the 450 scenario. Now what it said is it is by international energy agencies. So you have to reduce the energy related CO2 emissions to 450 parts per million by 2030. So that is one of the important objectives in provide if you want to limit the rise in temperature to just 2 degrees. Okay, so that is what is important thing. So under the proposal, CO2 emissions must decline by 13.8 billion tons compared to current projected increases. So that would mean that it has to if it is business as usual, it will go by the red line. And if we have to control it, then it has to come to this green line or something. Okay? Is there any? Anyway, so that means this is the challenge basically that we try to control it. In all this, if all these emissions are coming from all the power, transport, energy, industry. Okay, thank you. Okay, so these are the sectors which we had to control, and bulk of it is coming from power sector. Okay, so we had to reduce this from this point to this point if you want to see limit the temperature to 2 degrees. Okay, warming, global warming to go. Okay, now. Just to give an idea of the two major countries, we have strategies, China and USA. So this is the population is this, and share of world population 20%, this is 5%, and share of CO2 is China is 21% and USA is 20%, and per capita CO2 is China is 4.6 and USA is 18.7. Okay, and this is these are the sectors in which their emissions are going. And this is about 6.1 billion tons and this is 5.7 billion tons. So this is the emission situation in this. And so we have a data about you know, India, China and USA. So the population India, you know, this is 1,220 millions, China is 1,352 and USA is 311 and world is 6,903. Now per capita CO2 India is 1.12, China is 5.3 and USA is 18.6 and world is 4.5, and then the total CO2 emissions globally you know, as of now, is India is 1,366 tons per annum and China is 7,222 and USA is 5,801 and world is 30,000 something. So you can see that, you know, these numbers should sensitize us on what is right, what is wrong, and where we are going from this point of view. That's why the Indian Prime Minister said that, you know, our CO2 emissions per capita is so low compared to USA or something. So if you suddenly say you control it and we don't control it, there seems to be a skewing and mismatching of the policies and things like that. So these are, and so somewhere we have to together try to work out a situation where some of the catastrophes can be avoided. Okay. Now, world energy supply I mean, these are the ratios, these are well-known statistics, okay, in percentage-wise, what is available, okay. And then these are the annual greenhouse gas emissions from different sectors, okay, power, waste disposal, and so on. These are the divisions, the which are the activities, human activities, which are contributing to the greenhouse gas emissions, which are creating the problems. And of course, these are well known. We normally energy we have, one is conventional, another is renewable. And I always say, what is the role of scientists and technologists? Our role should be to make the conventional energy sustainable and renewable energy available. So these are two things we had to do. Okay, make this sustainable, make this available. Okay, now the this is the cost of electricity production in Canada, per cost of generation in Canada for different sources, etc. And though while the solar is being touted, but solar is still the most expensive for per unit of this one. Okay. So whereas wind may be smaller and other sources. So we should also take care of all other sources like small hydro, large hydro and various factors. So this is one of the factors we had to look at it. And as of now, fuel share in electricity generation is still coming from coal, which is a very major contributor to emissions. And of course, then natural gas, petroleum, then this is hydroelectric and other renewables. So this share, the objective is what you call by 2020, we should increase the contribution of renewables to about 20%. This is penetration, okay. And this is the world installed capacities. Still, it is thermal and renewable is small percentage. Nuclear and hydro. This is the share of the contributions. And among the renewables, these are all available. World renewable energy sources are large hydro, then small hydro, wind, biomass, geothermal, PV, and other things. So these are the various share of different renewables which are available in the country, okay, or which are exploited. And these are the share in world electricity generation. You will see the North America 30%, and next is Europe is 20%. Africa is 3%, and Asia Pacific other than Japan is 21%, Japan is 7%. Okay, so these are the different regions, the share in electricity generation as of now. Okay, and naturally that will also go in proportion to electricity consumption. Okay, so that is the, and these are the components of renewable energy components. Again, as I told, large hydro is a big component, and these are the other components of renewable energies which are been that is the share. Okay, and which are the renewable energies which we can exploit, okay, which can be tapped? And obviously these are hydro, wind, bio, solar, ocean, and of course geothermal, etc., are also there. So in hydro there are large and small. So we classify them as mini, micro, and pico, okay, in small hydro, because the small hydro require very minimal civil works and very minimal disturbance of the system. And of course, wind is another major one. And bio, you can have bio solid, liquid, gas, solar, PV, solar, thermal, and ocean can be OTEC, wave, and tide. And let me also tell you that in the nature, the energy is available broadly in three forms. One in the form of motion, another in form of heat, another in the form of light. These are three forms available. And mostly energy is also used in these three forms, human being. So you use energy for light, use energy for heat, and use energy for motion. Okay, broadly, because you have entertainment and other things are there. So this, but then how to make it manageable is the question. These are the region-wise electricity generation. Obviously, you see North America is the largest. And the smallest, of course, is Africa, and Asia Pacific, other than Japan, is this is the region wise how much electricity generated from different regions. Okay. Now, per capita electricity consumption, again, is another development index. Again, you know, North America is the very highest, nearly going to 12,000, and Africa is very small, less than 500. Okay, Asia Pacific, other than Japan, is per capita is also small. So obviously, there is a considerable disparities in inequalities in these factors, which is also deciding the quality of life of these people. Okay. Now, in 2000, globally, so much of electricity was produced, with the per capita globally is 2548, and by 2020, this has to go up to 25,500. Now, where does it come from? So, there will be this much increase in electricity to be produced. Where does it come from? We have so much concern about the global warming and emission issues. Okay. Now, these are the top countries in installed capacities. US, China, Japan, Russia, India and China, these are the values of gigawatts of installed capacities of these countries. Okay. Now, as I mentioned earlier, our slogan must be make the conventional energy sustainable, renewable energy available. Okay. So, that should be all our technology development effort should be. Now, what are the so called special features of renewable energy? Okay. Now, what are special features are? They are non-portable. You can't change it. I can't, you know, wind somewhere is there, I can't bring it here. So, the question is that you have to install your generating systems where the renewables are available. And renewables are highly dispersed in the world, just like population is dispersed. Okay. Therefore, you create electricity where it is available and give it to the people who are nearby. Okay. So, that is what is now going to be the so-called off-grid, dispersed systems. Okay. Now, the generation must be at the location of source. Then, solar energy is uniformly spread. Okay. And wind and hydro are location specific. And bio is also more uniformly spread. And technology must be, and what should be technology? It should be economical, viable, acceptable, maintainable and user-friendly. It must be user friendly because most of the people in those places are not necessarily techno savvy. Okay. So, this is the challenge. Okay. And then in the globally you find there are two countries which are having the high growth rate, okay, as of now, and these are China and India. Therefore, and in both countries it will be, you know, and they are the one which will have a highest growth in power generation. So, and India is the fifth largest in terms of energy use. So, there is a concern of increased emission in these sectors. So, this is a point. Okay. And then, you know, this is the typically in Indian energy scene is thermal, hydro, nuclear, renewable. In fact, India has done well on renewable. It is at present it is about 10%. Okay. It is the share. Okay. Now, to meet the requirement, you know, India's requirement of power at present about 160 gigawatt. Now, it has to add about 78,000 megawatts in 11th plan and 83,000 in 12th plan and 100,000 in the 13th plan, mostly maybe from coal. Therefore, it is a big challenge and a very tough situation in case they want to meet the basic requirement of the population. Okay. So, rural electrification, they have funded for about so many villages, but 118,000 villages, unelectrified villages have to be electrified. There is a project and augment about 354,000 villages to be augmented. So, therefore, renewable energy can be the key to energize this population. Okay. Now, they have sanctioned $60 billion for the generation of electricity. So, these are the India's renewable potential achievements as of October 2009. So, solar, there is a 6 megawatt installed, waste to energy about 67 megawatt, and cogeneration bagasse, there are sugar plants are there, so use the bagasse of the sugar plants to producing that. It is about, that is about 1,241 megawatts. And wind potential is supposed to be 50,000, people say about 100,000 megawatts. So installed as of now is 11,000. India is the fifth in the world in terms of wind electric installation after USA, Spain, Germany, China. Okay. And small hydro is around 2,500 megawatts and biomass power is about 820 megawatts. So this is 15,000 megawatts is installed in the renewable sector. Okay. From this, and these are the grid connected renewable potential. Okay. From different sectors. In the large hydro, we have about 100,000 megawatt potential, and these are the electricity generated from different sources in these from these sectors. Okay. Now, next is off-grid renewable. So these are the external to the grid is biomass, gasifier, waste, solar PV, and aerogenerator hybrid. So these are some of the projects and plans under implementation that they have been done. Okay. So now we come to some realities. Now the 2 billion people in the world do not have access to grid electricity. Okay. And next is, so therefore we have to think of a distributed decentralized generation. Okay. It has to come to center stage. Okay. Not the large grids only. So India is investing 250 billion for this distributed generation for rural electrification. And so we can think of, so new power plant can be a rooftop, basement or a backyard power plants. So they are all, you see, you can think of a, we should think of a new paradigm in terms of the power situation. So small capacity power plants and installed in millions. Okay, that may be the new thing. Okay. So, therefore, as of now, half of the over billion Indian population do not have access to grid electricity. And in the so-called electrified villages, less than half of the people have connection to their houses. Only more privileged ones will have electricity in their houses. And therefore, if you say electricity for all, and also 24/7, it is a challenge. Okay, this has to be made. And even in the electrified house places, not only will, average supply of electricity is about 4 hours per day, average. Therefore, there are 20 hours per day they don't have electricity. So it is not drawing the wire that matters, but the wire must also carry current. That's also equally important. And I mean, these are the several challenges, though there have been considerable progress compared to what it was 30-40 years ago. Of course, there are other countries, you know, other day I learned that in Afghanistan, which has been war ravaged, apparently there is large parts are still dark from that point of view. There may be many places in Africa and so on. Therefore, we have to address this issue. Okay. So therefore, there is a need of off-grid. Bulk of the targeted population live in rural remote places and supply through the grid is not always the best solution. So off-grid power and distribution using renewable energy is attractive. For even in Canada, I think there are a lot of dispersed population. In fact, I just saw a document which said there are, I think, 500 communities which are disconnected, off-grid. Okay, in this region, and majority of them are being supplied through diesel, which is again a very rare commodity, and it will lead to emissions. Therefore, this is a challenge. Okay, we have to. So we think of the so-called microgrid. Okay, now a peculiar supply of the power supply many developing countries is erratic supply. So there are already grid is available, but it is erratic. It's not carrying current. So many consumers resort to standby inverters. You see what is happening is, it is said that in India, total installed capacity 160,000 megawatts, and the people have installed the private 35,000 megawatts of diesel generating sets in India. So that is strategy. So you can see it becomes almost 20%. Okay, because of the grid power is not reliable. You create your own standby power. Now that is definitely not a green situation. Okay, therefore resort to standby inverters and diesel sets, etc. Therefore, renewable energy storage system with microgrid. So can we make a non-24/7 system to a 24/7 system. At present, there is wires there, but the people are not getting 24/7 electricity. Can we think of a microgrid? Can we give a technology, use microgrid, new smart grid, use new technologies, use new renewables? You combine all of them to make sure that that unhealthy grid can be made healthy. So this is the technological challenge we are posing. Okay? And we have, you know, one of the objective of my coming here, we thought, can we think of a, you know, Canada-India initiative in this? There is enough of technical expertise, manpower, need. Okay, you also have dispersed populations, and we also have dispersed population. Can we think of such a thing? In fact, we have, in 2008, we had a symposium at Ryerson Universities on this issue. Then, as Jatin told, we had the Indo-Canada workshop in Delhi, and also we had our research policy for sustainable energy, etc. In fact, I have a copy of the proceedings of the Delhi workshop here, and also we have, these are available in INA websites, what are they. So, we have worked policy, there is no problem, okay. What is to be done has been listed out. So, there is a recipe book available, but we had to, somebody has to cook and serve. Okay. This is the main challenge. In fact, there is this International Academy of Engineering Technology, SEETS. They have brought out a document, Deployment of Low Emission Technologies for Electric Power Generation Response to Climate Change. So that is also a document which has been, which is here with me. So this has also been brought out, and where they have made all the recommendations, you know, what need to be done, okay? The suggestion which says it recommends international collaboration of engineers, technologists and scientists in the crucial matter of providing the world with secure low emission electricity at the lowest possible cost. And it recommends research leading to technical breakthroughs and cost reduction in renewable energy and new technology for electricity distribution networks to optimize system to handle fluctuating renewable sources and loads. Because renewable energy is fluctuating, loads are fluctuating. So obviously these are some of the major recommendations. Okay, and one can always say, you know, how do you compare Canada and India? And of course, many things are comparable, many things are not comparable. Population is, for example, is not comparable. Because total Canada population is equal to the population of three cities in India. Okay? Delhi, Mumbai and Kolkata together is the total population of Canada. Okay? So you can imagine. Now, there are differing dispersed population. Okay? Dispersed population, India is one type and Canada is another type. Per capita energy and emissions are very much varying. And commonality, large English-knowing population in both countries, of course. Therefore, perhaps the total number of people knowing English in India may be more than that in Canada, okay? From that point of view. Large Indian diaspora and students in Canada. Then also, they belong to Commonwealth, democracy, rule of law. Such commonalities are there. And of course, recent events, you have the IFA. You know, there a lot of big hype was there in this, and also the editorial in Toronto Star said there must be more closer India Canada bondage, etc. And recently there has been there is a India Canada Energy Forum was set up in 2009. Now when all these facilitation things are there, now should we not take it further? It should not be just on the paper, it should be in the field. Okay? So, this is what we can explore. Now, how to translate these well-meaning policies to action? Okay? And then, can we initiate joint projects? Who will facilitate this? So, this is what we are trying to say. So, what we call it as, anyway, these are all policies. There is a Planning Commission Integrated Energy Policy, which says there should be a fund to support R&D, etc. So there is so Government of India has also made this so-called off-grid application. You know, this is one of the declared policies, off-grid applications, and then it says such application not only replace fossil fuels but also make significant contribution to reduction in consumption. and it has advantage of production of consumption of points and does away with land and environmental related issues. Therefore, there is a declared policy of the government of India to support in a massive way this off-grid power generation and space system. So, I'm just reproducing, these are the policies, rural electrification, and their plan of 150 villages, etc. So, ministry has plans to cover about 10,000 villages from biomass based systems and over 1,000 villages from solar power by 2022. So, these are some of the policies. For example, telecom towers and industrial power generation are areas where this off-grid can be of use. Okay. Now, the problem is developing and developed economies may have a different type of needs. Grid connected off-grid system may have a different type of technologies. So, therefore, each country may have different need and scope, but what we need to do is think global and act local. We should think about the world but act locally. So, that is the plan we need to do. Therefore, as we say, in the power generation, there are two baskets. One is the grid-fed systems, other is the off-grid systems. Grid-fed systems are mostly by developed economies and off-grid systems are mostly by developing economies. So, technology may be different for the above. Okay. Now, what I am proposing here is an integrated general off-grid system. Okay. And so, we have a conventional source, renewable source, these are the systems. Okay. Conventional renewable storage systems, etc. So, let us say we have a main grid and we have the diesel gensets. These are the conventional one. Okay, then we have all the renewable sources, small hydro, wind, bio, solar, and maybe ocean geothermal, etc. And we have an energy storage system, okay, which will have hydrogen, fuel cells, batteries, supercapacitors, pump storage, flywheel, etc. And then we have loads. Loads are domestic loads, commercial loads, agricultural loads, industrial loads. Okay, and they have lighting, heating, HVAC, motion, entertainment, IT and so on. So, these are domestic loads, they are commercial loads and they are industrial loads, they are agricultural loads. Okay. And we have linear, non-linear, balanced, unbalanced, dynamic. So, our loads are also very erratic. Different types of loads are there. Okay. Now, so this is a broad scenario I am proposing. Let us say there is a grid, main grid which may or may not be available. Then I create a microgrid. And it is fed by all these sources. Diesel will be a conventional one which feeds the microgrid. Then solar, wind, hydro, bio, storage, and also storage system. Storage system may feed or take from the, this is the power flow. Okay. Then we have to create an energy management system which will interact with the sources, and also other side we have the load, domestic, hybrid vehicles, commercial, industrial, agricultural, etc. So, and we have energy management system. Therefore, we have to think of this in a generalized integrated, this is my broad scheme. And site specific, that can be a subset of this, depending upon the situation. Therefore, we can have different possible schemes. This scheme may be as low as 5 kilowatt and as high as 1 megawatt. Okay. So, depending upon the situation. So, there may be a situation where there is one source and one load. Okay? It can be a bioenergy driven generator feeding the local loads, or a small hydro generator feeding local loads, a wind. So, I can think of a wind turbine feeding the local loads. So, the only load has to be adjusted as per the wind speed. So, high wind, I have more lights. Low wind, I'll have less lights. Okay, then solar, sun also. I said least controlled situation. So you control the load as per the solar insulation. So let us say this is the primitive scheme. But this is one thing. A system in Montana. In fact, he called me up and we have developed some electrical systems. So he wanted to use it. So it is off grid. So, he has a field in Montana and then what he does is to light, electrify the neighboring places, and he will just want to control based on the wind speed, the number of lights to be controlled, etc. Okay. So, in hybrid system, now we can think of next is hybrid systems. So more than one source, okay, wind battery, wind diesel, wind solar, wind hydro, solar battery. So there are all, you know, that can be the thing. And third scheme is there's a main grid, okay, and community is already electrified by the main grid, but the grid is weak and not reliable with lot of disconnections. So use the grid, that grid will become a main microgrid in islanded operation. So when the main grid, so it is a dead grid, you have to energize it. So connect a renewable energy source to this microgrid and connect storage system to microgrid. Therefore, we have to think of a make an unreliable grid system to a reliable microgrid system. So this is the next type challenge. And the last and important one is there are already communities supplied by diesel generators. For example, you know, there is a project by Kasabanika in here and several places. And in India, there is the Andaman Nicobar Island, Lakshadweep, then Bet Dwarka, and and Ladakh. Several places are there which are supplied by diesel. Then diesel may continue as a main source, but use the grid as that existing grid, a microgrid in island operation. Connect renewable energy source to this grid and connect storage system to microgrid, and so that you can conserve diesel. Therefore, this is another scheme we can think of. Now, microgrid, you know, again, you know, we should say, what is this microgrid? Everybody talk microgrid, smart grid, etc. I mean, is it like God that we don't know, okay, or which you can't realize, and which is ideal, okay? So, but we need to know now. India has commissioned a renewable in Terry. Yesterday I saw a note like this. So therefore, it is said that, you know, these are the statement of the minister. They are smartly installed. So renewable energy is important by the power minister of India. He said renewable energy is important as it reaches unreachable areas. Okay, this is one of the things. Okay, so smart grids would be very useful for standalone projects. So this is a declared and known thing. So we have to make it work. So therefore, a smart grid or a microgrid is an intelligent electricity distribution network operating at or below 11 kV, where the energy demand is effectively and intelligently managed by diverse range of distributed energy sources, such as solar, PV, etc. So this is the paradigm. This is the new situations that we have to address. Okay, on this. Okay. So it will have advanced sensing, communication, control technologies for smart grids, okay, and it will be for generation, distribution, but also utilization of electricity in a more intelligent, effective manner. Okay. So such an application will not only foster effective interconnection and utilization of multiple renewable energy, so that means renewable energy sources, but will also help in advancing access to energy to last mile in the optimum, improving the efficiency of the overall system. Okay. So smart mini grid has a great potential in large commercial, industrial complexes, hospitals, shopping malls, complexes, apartments, residential complexes, etc. So this is being considered to be a viable solution combination of this. So this microgrid, therefore, is the technology to be developed, perfected, generalized, integrated, and deployed. So this is what is the challenge now. Okay, hopefully through Canada, we are thinking of some collaboration. So now one thing is, it is multidisciplinary. Okay, everybody with whatever background experience has contributed to this. Somebody in physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics, electrical, mechanical, civil, electronics, computers, you name any area, he can contribute. Okay, therefore it can be a very interesting systemic approach for this project. Okay, now I'll quickly run you through some of the Indian initiatives, and bioenergy is one of the major things. You know, India is agro-based economy, and there are lot of bioenergy of different forms are available. So there have been and if you have a bio, you can run an engine, run a generator, and then to supply to the loads. And there has been some work we have done. Of course, biogas is one of the important things, and of course, there is a composition of these things, etc. Because of the limitation of time, I will have to quickly run through the things. And there are biomass, biogas driven engines, green standalone systems, Okay, what we discovered was some of the bio of this thing is the price of the biofuels are fluctuating. The farmers, etc., are now changing, are rising the prices when they found demand is increasing. Okay. So the person who has set up with certain economics, he is finding problem because there is no security of the bio source. Okay. So this is the fuel prices, etc. Okay. So the typically, you know, you have the animal waste or a dung and you create ethanol through this biochemical route, okay, or bio, you have a biomass and produce syngas and methanol, etc., through this process. And now one thing is the biogas is not easily transportable, so you have to produce your whatever utilized plants wherever it is available. So these are some of the statements, you know, maybe I leave this information. These are all the massive biogas plant, because India has a separate ministry for renewable energy where they have taken lot of actions of setting up these bio based generating plants, both off grid and grid connected, in these places. These are the policies programs of Government of India on biomass, and this is the biogas and manure development program, biogas distributed and grid power generation program, and the biomass grid fed Indian potential. India is supposed to have a potential about 16,000 megawatts, like that. And current portion agro waste is of 16,000 megawatts. And this is a grid power program. I mean, these are some statistics to this. And grid fed biomass power, there are some information. And off grid power, these are some of the plans that they have. Okay. In fact, they have set up biomass gasifier system for power in villages in Bihar, etc. Now the thing is, you are thinking of a power plant from tree to power, husk to power. Okay. So you can think of our cow dung to power, then sewage to power. So like that. So your sources are all, your whole thing you are changing. Okay. So you have to think of a new way of technology for wood to power and so on. Okay. See, rice husk based biogas, you know, this is again another project in Bihar. The company is called Husk Power System. Okay. They have developed these things. Okay. So there are success stories in this front. There are programs for this year. And this is one of the plants in Karnataka. They are a big plant, about say 20 megawatts, using biomass, etc. So usually you have a biomass, a gasifier, generator, and feed it to the grid or off grid. Okay. Then this is off grid biomass to the load, in the same way. Again, from cow dung to electricity, you can use lighting, cooking, etc. And this is husk power. You have the, you know, rice husk. You produce biomass. You have a generator. It is providing to both industry, domestic as well agriculture. These are the in the Bihar. And we worked on this. This is a new generator we developed for the engine driven. So this can be a biomass engine. This is a typically 1 kilowatt small one which we have patented. And we have this work. This is our lab in IIT Delhi. So this is we are developing a 5 kilowatt unit induction generator which we got it made by the local ABB, and which was a special design. And we have tested it, because why we went for 5 kilowatt, we discovered that every villages, you know, 5 kilowatt is a big demand. We, you know, as of now there were no such generators available. People would like to have this, so this can be produced in millions. Okay. So you want a reliable engine connected generator with a local loads, and this is one of the projects. Of course, this is the electric. We have developed these controllers, etc., and which ensures that the power quality is maintained properly when it is driven by an engine. Engine driven, whatever may be the load, it works. These are some test results. And next, we have done on the hydro front. Hydro, you know, again, there's a lot of statistics I have given in this hydro, world hydro potential, small hydro, and so on. But I'll only quickly tell you what we have done on this hydro. We have set up a few units. This we have developed the electrical systems there. I mean, this is one of the small hydro units in Karnataka. And see, one of the things about hydro is, again, you know, like engine, you don't want too much controls. If it is engine driven, you don't want to make a complicated control. So a simple voltage regulator or something should do to do the thing. So engine has a simple governor system. Small hydro, you don't want to have any control on the water, no mechanical control. There is enough power in the wind, in the water, and that power should be fully utilized. Now the consumer doesn't want all the power all the time. So if I have a 10 kilowatt unit, consumer may not need a 10 kilowatt all the time. Therefore, you need to develop a load diverter or a load controller. So we worked on this electronic load controller. Okay, and so we have in this off-grid systems, we have done a turbine design as well, pump as turbine. We developed the electronic load controller, and therefore we have we call it as a micro and a pico hydro systems. So small hydro. Okay, so you need to have, if you have some waterfall at the backyard, even if 5-10 kilowatt, you can put it at the back. Whole of the Himalayas have thousands and thousands of such sites, and even southern parts in Western Ghats areas in India. And I'm sure many places also may have this one. So we need to, we have worked on this area, and this is the scheme. So there is a river flowing somewhere. You create a head, have a turbine, a generator, and then supply to nearby places. So this itself is a microgrid here. So there are a lot of interesting challenges we worked on this, and we developed, we have installed, based on our technology what we worked, we have installed in four, this is in the southern South India, this Western Ghat region in Karnataka. These are the places, five places which I have shown in red, they have been installed, typically about 5 kilowatt. It is working well, and it is generating electricity. And it is run by the local people who are not even fully literates. As boys who are not even primary school educated, they are running it. Okay, these systems. Okay, and then this is the other one which I told you in Punjab. This is the canals. So there are these vertical axis turbines. So they would like to develop proper generating systems. So I'm just trying to pose these are technological challenges that we face. Okay, so now the standalone systems that Punjab, they want to develop 1, 5, 10, 15, 25 kilowatt systems based on this canal based hydro systems, etc. Okay, so this is how the system is working here. We have a tank, then we have the powerhouse here, and so on. There is a channel, 4-bay penstock, powerhouse, turbine, and a generator. The generator was again an induction generator which we designed. We developed this electronic controller, and so the scheme is, this is a constant power here. So you have a generator, and then there is a consumer load which will be changing. Then whatever is surplus power goes into the so-called dump load. Okay, so this electronic load control is critical to this system. Okay, so so this is the electronics out of this. Maybe we have a rectifier, chopper, power electronics, etc. And these are all the control system which we have recently developed, introducing rectifiers and choppers and the development for these generators. So what we do is we take a normal three-phase motor, then use it as a generator with this type of connections, etc. Okay, and this is actually in one of the sites. This is the specially designed generator. Okay, and this is the controller which we have done. It is fully engineered in our lab, and it's working, and it's packaged for the small hydro system. And this is the that means you can take this controller, connected to a machine and then connect to a turbine, and it supplies power, and it's very reliable. We have tested for a long time. Okay, so this is the inside of that control box, what we have developed. This is our lab setup there in our, it is when we tested in our lab, and these are some experimental results where to show that all the time the load voltage is constant, irrespective of the type of load, we are maintaining the power quality to the consumers. And these are the actual demonstration. This is one of the sites where it was installed, okay, at their doorstep. So you see that there is electricity in their house, okay. This is installed, and these are all the, they are basically local tribals, except this person who was our project staff, last fellow, okay. Others are the locals, and they are using it, okay. So in fact, now there is much more demand, and I think hundreds of people are coming into this, okay. And okay, can I take 2 minutes? Or okay, I'll take 5 minutes just to see other two. One is the wind and solar this thing. So we have seen that it is possible to use bioenergy for off-grid generation, small hydro energy for off-grid generation. Okay, and the wind, of course, is another player which has a very vast potential. And there are vast regions in the world which are windy regions, and okay, and wind, of course, this is a big change, increase in wind installations over the years, as we see here, and the global wind capacities, you know, and these are the countries, you know, Germany, US, Spain, India, and China. These are the major players in the wind potential. And these are the installed capacity in different regions, Africa, Asia, etc. As on 2009, these are all grid connected, incidentally. So these are the, in Asia, China has 25,000, India has about 10,000. This is the installed capacities of wind systems. And there are different makers of the wind systems. I mean, these are, you know, these are the wind machine manufacturers in India. So they have, and these are the windy regions in parts of India. So you'll see quite a large part of India has a good wind potential. Okay, so here we have wind potential, and these regions have a good hydro potential. Okay, so that way the renewable energy can be exploited as it is available. This is, of course, the same picture, and this is one of the windy. You know, this is a about one. 1 megawatt machine of a general GE. Now this is in a place in Karnataka. Okay, of course this is the data, and now the incidentally what is happening? My concern is this. This is the all grid connected wind machines, and we went to a village near. We went to that place. We went to a village in the downstream, but that village doesn't have electricity. Okay. So this all grid connected, you know, electricity goes to big cities. Okay. Now, if there is wind in this region, why not in the village? Why not you have rooftop windmills in every house and create their own self-sustaining energy systems for them? So this is the challenge, okay, which is possible. Because these are the modern wind turbines. There is a lot of work. These are grid connected. Many people may know that you know these are all so generators. So there is a lot of technology issues of the energy conversion system from wind to the wire, okay, wind to the grid, okay. So these are all different you know type of systems of the. There are, of course, these are fed to the grid. This is the development of wind turbine technology over the years. So broadly, you have a horizontal axis or a vertical axis wind systems, okay, for the wind generators. And these are, that means you have wind generate, wind electric system, generator, and feeding to the grid. And off-grid systems, so this is what we are looking of off-grid now. Off-grid, what we say is, you have a wind diesel or wind bio. So let us have a wind turbine and parallel with a diesel set or a bio system. Now, that means what we need to do is, there is a load here, and then either there is a lot of wind there. This one position is lot of wind, but the load, they don't want the power at all. Then what do you do with that wind? Okay, so you may have to either dump it somewhere, okay, or use it. Other case, maybe there is no wind, but the consumer wants power. So in that case, the diesel should take care. Okay. Therefore, we need to have a proper balancing, energy balancing. That's why energy management system is required here, to make sure that the total power in the wind and the diesel is equal to the power required by the load and the dump load, etc. Okay. So this is a similarly wind battery hybrid. You can have a wind and a converter and a battery and inverter and so on. Okay. Then wind solar hybrid. So that's also another thing. We worked on a parallel two wind generators feeding to a common load. These are some electronics into this. So this is the one of the typical characteristics of wind system is it's a variable speed. For different wind speed, the turbine characteristics will be like this. That means you want at any wind speed you must operate at different generator speed. Okay. Turbine speed will be different to compare to the wind speeds. Therefore, your controller, it's quite a challenge. You must, if it is off-grid systems, you must develop your controller in such a way that it operates at these respective speeds. Okay. This is the important factor that we need to work it out. Of course, this is we have worked also what is a wind hydro hybrid. This is the system for a this is a wind system and a hydro system, and we have got electronics here to feed. This is the consumer off grid load. So I think this is to tell you the type of challenges which are there. These are the simulated results of wind hydro hybrid. Okay. To show that it is possible using power electronics to make sure that the consumer will get a quality power. Okay. So this is the issues there. Last is the solar, because many people are now very much accustomed to solar technologies, which requires the converters technologies and so on. So sun is available. But the question again here is you must have a good power quality. So the characteristics are for a solar panel, the current versus voltage. So for different values of sunlight insulation, we say, so if it is a dim or a brighter one, it will follow different characteristics. That means for each level of solar insulation, you must operate at certain voltage and current and certain power, okay, to get the maximum power extracted from this. So if it is off grid, that means your load you should go on changing. You must go on changing load as per the sunlight. Okay, this is one way. Or you try to have a hybrid system where somebody else will give that much of a balanced power requirement, okay, etc. So this is one of the solar rooftop plants. So what you need to do is for a given solar insulation, so either you feed to the grid or to the load, so you need to have a proper power electronics converter systems for this. Okay. So we have a declared national solar mission. India has potential of 5,000 trillion units of energy is incident on Indian soil. That's what they say. So 5,000 trillion units of electricity energies on Indian soil. So most parts get 4 to 7 kilowatts per hour per square meters per day. Okay. So they are saying planet have 20,000 megawatts by 2022. This is the very ambitious plan, a solar plan, and 10,000 by 2030 and so on. So this is a big solar mission in India. And also promote off-grid application of 1000 megawatts by 2017 and 2000 megawatts by 2022. These are declared policies with the government. That means from solar energy off-grid to produce 1000 megawatts by 2017 in next 6 years. Okay. So are we ready with the proper technologies? Okay. So therefore these are the targets of solar energy, okay, and now what should be the global synergy? So what we need to do is the energy crisis is real. So there is one saying, in India, in our Sanskrit saying, what they say is, whole world is a family. This is the saying, whole world is a family. That means both developed countries and developing countries have to complementarily work together. Because in the energy crisis, all will swim or sink together. This is the situation. Either you all swim together or sink together. Okay? Nobody can say, I will consume whatever the global resources and don't bother about others. I think that is business as usual will not go. So we need to, therefore, what I have proposed, in fact, which I am just formulating in the so-called Canada-India project, is study the nature of available sources and loads, objectives, develop suitable energy conversion systems from source to load. Okay, so we have to think of this. Study the propensity of the above individual hybrid mode. Develop suitable controllers for this above. Develop suitable unified integrated energy management system to account for any type of source and load in any combination as per site condition. So we need to have a total technology development effort. Design and develop tailor-made system for the identified sites in India. What we are dreaming is have a few sites in Canada, few sites in India, work together to see and then install the demonstration units based on the above developed technology. So that means let us have a demonstration unit, okay? And that means as of now there are people ready with the plates, okay? And then we as a technologist must be prepared to prepare the dishes and serve. Okay, that is the situation. Recipe is also available more or less. Okay, so the question is the linkage of this. So I'm only trying to propose this type of a situation which I feel is implementable. Okay, and we have identified the organizations in India who are prepared to work on it. Okay, academic institutions and some universities. And even we have talked to industry like General Electric, then research institutions, and as I listed here, and also government agencies, etc. So at least in theoretically, all of them say yes, we can be on board and try to work together on this front. Okay, so this is what is the plan of working on this. Okay, so I've told you our dreams, okay, and then can we all work together to make such a thing happen? Because in all this scheme of things, worth of the pudding is in the eating. So long as the people get a quality electricity and 24/7, only then we can say energy problem is solved. And we can all academicians go on producing hundreds of research papers, but that will not give them electricity. So our role is to make sure, give the power back to the people. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Murthy. We have time to take questions, so please, anyone with a question?
Thank you.
No questions at all?
India's generation of nuclear power is about 3% or something like that?
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I saw the figures.
Yes.
How much of money is spent in terms of percentage from nuclear energy?
Oh, that we will not know. Because this money spent in developing these things are not made as open this thing. Though of course that is also one of nuclear power is also considered to be an important this thing. But, we are as far as the money spent, I think information is not available. See, the point is that even in remote place, you see, it costs you at least 10 rupees per unit, which is 25 cents. It costs about 25 cents per unit to produce one unit for a remote village in India. Maybe it may be the same thing. So even if you can produce less than that by any other source, then it is economical. That's the only thing.
The reason I'm asking is, historically,
the connection between Canada and India, was in terms of the CANDU reactor.
Yeah.
Now it looks like after what happened in Japan, there's a definite decline, of course, of nuclear.
Yeah.
Even in the United States.
Yes.
So, you know, the question of decentralization of generation of power, which you're suggesting, which I think is the thing to go, is also related to the socio-economic problem.
Yes.
Increasing urbanization in India and so forth, you know, all the things. So I was wondering, actually, the budgetary model also becomes a bit.
Yeah, it is, that is true. Socio-economic
situation. The answer is not known to your question. At least he doesn't have, I'm sure somebody knows the answer. Any other questions for Professor Murthy? Yes.
Yeah.
You suggested that a 3 kilowatt was sort of a good size that could be mass produced. Put into the village situation.
Yeah.
Is that correct? And so what are the loads? Hmm. 3 kilowatt is tiny.
Yes.
By Canadian standards.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
What's the size of that village and what's the load?
You see, you look at, you know, typically, you know, the one of the thing is, and weather-wise, in India's situation is not that bad. Here you have extreme weather. So, we don't spend that much for weather conditioning. Therefore, a typical village, all they need is a light and a fan. Okay? So, 1 kilowatt will be a very good load to a house in India today. So therefore, if I have a small village with 10 houses maybe, even a 10 kilowatt unit may serve their purpose. Okay? So the needs are very, I would say, modest from that point of view. Of course, it is not that they have to be satisfied. You know, you can increase it, no doubt. Okay? I am telling, even if 3 kilowatt power is available, let us exploit it. That's what we are saying. If you get more, yes, more the merrier. Okay? So it is a question of producing millions with smaller units or big sizes with smaller numbers. So that's, I think it has, everything has to be site specific. See, so we had to develop the technology like that. Okay.
One thing that comes to mind as an engineer is the big systems are efficient.
Yes.
And the small systems are going to be less and less efficient.
Yes, yes.
And if your energy is free,
yeah,
perhaps doesn't matter. But when do you start to confront problems of efficiency?
Yeah, you see, the thing is that if the small hydropower, if the available power itself is 20 kilowatt, I would just exploit 20 kilowatt. Okay, and I'm getting that from nature free. Okay, efficiency may be 60%, so I'll still get 12 kilowatts. Okay, so I will not wait for only 100 kilowatt to be available. So now the question is, efficiency is a very, very tricky situation. See, solar PV is very inefficient from that point of view. Okay, because we are getting sunlight free, it's okay. So the in electricity, you know, one statement is there that no power is costlier than no power. I hope you got this thing. So no power is costlier than having no power. So it's always, you know, sickness is always more expensive than health. Okay? Or not. so that is the type of thing. So we have to create, now the multiplier effect of these giving electricity to remote people is enormous. See, it helps in education. You know, if you look at, you know, compared to a dark situation, so education, then some transport, then healthcare. So it will have a quality of life will tremendously make an impact. So I think it's worthwhile investing and not bothering about too much on economics and efficiency. Okay, I think we had to set aside economics and efficiency a little. Right, that can be taken later, but we had to give them electricity. Come what may. Yeah, that is what we are suggesting. Okay.